Speaking of artists who didn't blow up that I love, when I was doing A&R Columbia Records, one of the artists I signed was Kenna, who's this amazing artist. He's from Ethiopia originally and then raised in Virginia. Signed by Fred Durst first, made a record for Interscope. One of the most played videos in the history of MTV2, and the record never came out. And then I signed him and put that record out on Columbia, and then I started working on a second album with him. And then all of a sudden, Columbia didn't want to release it, so Pharrell, of course, from the Neptunes, you know, decided to release it and add a couple songs. Kenna's got this amazing story. He worked on one of the tracks. He did a Ryan Adams cover with
it. Yeah, that was the second one that we did, and there's this Ryan Adams song, Amy. The Ryan Adams record, Heartbreaker, is one of my favorite records of the past 15 years.
Oh, I mean, Come Pick Me Up, whenever I hear the lyrics to that, it just blows me away.
It's amazing. I played it for Kenna. A lot of the people that I did that sang the songs on my album had never heard the original song, like Santo Gold, had never heard Pretty Green by The Jam, but I'd just play them my backing track in the original and go, hey, do you want to sing this? And we'd go on the internet, print up the lyrics, and 2 hours later, they'd be in the booth singing. The same thing with the Ryan Adams song. And Kenna's just brilliant. He's made two great records, and I think he just keeps getting the shaft as far as the label situations and that stuff kind of goes. But I feel like somebody like that, you know, his record will come out. And when you do go to his shows, they're like people that are fanatical about him. Like there's a certain amount of people that he really seems to speak to and love what he does.
Yeah, I truly believed in him, and it was one of those things that I wish had connected. And I hope one day it really does, because he's an incredible talent and deserves it. I'm glad you gave him a shot on there. And by the way, on the version, thanks for covering The Jam, one of my all-time favorite bands too. Pretty Green, great song for Sound Effects.
Amazing.
You know, I saw that show. I saw them do that tour here. They played the Ritz, which is Webster Hall now, and they only did like 4 shows in America for that album, because Paul was kind of, you know, he just didn't want to do a long tour here. And it was such an incredible show. By the way, we're in the studio with Mark Ronson. It's 101.9 RXP at 923. Matt Pinfield and Leslie Fram here in the morning. Mark, of course, Amy Winehouse. There's so much love for that record. It won so many awards, but then there's so much controversy as well. But tell me how you ended up getting involved with Amy Winehouse and producing Back to Black.
A friend of mine named Guy Moot at EMI in the UK said I'd heard her first record and
Frank,
and I like the song In My Bed and a few things, and he said, do you want to meet Amy? She's working on a new record. It was about 4 years after the first one, so she was in New York for days, so she came to my studio, and she showed up and I said hi, and she looked at me really weird, and she's like, oh, you're Mark Ronson. I thought you were like some old Jewish guy with a beard or something like that. So, well, I guess, I don't know what that means. Maybe she thought I was Ricky Rubin. So we went upstairs and she just played me all the music that she liked. When I start working on a record with people, you like to get a sense of what they like. And she said she liked all the 60s girl group and kind of 60s jukebox pop music. And so she left that day and I kind of was trying to desperately come up with something that would work and that she would like, and came up with the piano and the chords for Back to Black, and she came back the next day and she said, I love it, and then she stayed for 2 weeks and we worked on most of the record during that and then tracked it with the deck a little bit later.
Which is incredible. And Valerie in the studio right now with Mark Ronson. Mark is just one of our favorite producers, remixers, recording artists, and he's in the studio with us right now. Mark, you know, when I first started seeing your name around the city, I was hearing rumors that you were Mick Ronson's son. And you, of course, I found out that wasn't true. Mick Ronson, who played with Bowie in the Ziggy Stardust years, who's great.
People get really excited. They're like, oh my God, is your dad Mick Ronson? I'm like, no, but my stepdad's Mick Jones. They're like, from the Clash? And it's like, no.
Mick Jones from Foreigner.
Which I love Foreigner.
Yeah, they made some great records.
People, you know. It's always the third Mick that they get. But I think that, Mick Ronson did, and not only was an amazing guitar player, but did all those string arrangements on Life on Mars and all the Bowie records. It's just incredible. But his son, I think, kept reading that my dad was Mick Ronson because the press would keep getting it wrong. And he wrote me a thing saying, like, are you my long-lost brother? Yeah. And I wrote him back. I was like, no, I'm really sorry. It's just these press people keep getting wrong. And I was, oh, great. Well, then could you issue a statement saying you're not, because it's leaking? interfering with my own music career, which I'm trying to get off the ground right now.
That is so funny, man. Now, you listen, Amy, of course, has been dealing with so much controversy and all the press madness. And, you know, I was saying on the air with Chris Martin the other day, Leslie and I, Chris in here from Coldplay, we were talking about the fact that it's just upsetting to me. Like, when I saw the picture of her on the street in just a bra, in a really painful situation emotionally, and I was really angry at the press for what they were doing to her, because, you know, everybody has personal struggles. And that really pissed me off when I saw it. What's going on as far as, are you talking about making another record, Mark? And do you think you'll work with her again?
I think we tried to go in a few times, and it's gotten a bit to the point where it's like, okay, when you have 10 songs and you're ready, then, you know, call me.
Yeah.
Because she's a really good friend, and I have a lot of love for her, and it's just, you know, it's I just can't deal with certain aspects of it.
Yeah. Do you think you'll be working with Lily Allen again?
Well, actually, Lily and I went in the studio when she was working on this new record, and Lily and I speak a lot, and we did some stuff that I happened to really love, but she didn't think was kind of good enough for the record, so you can't really let that get in the way of the friendship. But I've heard most of her new record, it's really good.
Yeah, now, with the Amy thing again, I know, like, when you have somebody you care about and you love in a working situation, you're seeing the pain and, you know, the things that the addiction can get in the way, it makes it very difficult. You kind of have to step back sometimes, and it's even bad.
I think so. I think my thing is just like, you know, we have me working with her. I feel like it's one of the things that I guess is a positive thing in her life. And if I can use that as a sort of carrot at the end of the stick in any sort of way, then that's what I'll do.
Absolutely.
Tell us about your record label.
Well, Alito is a label that we have. It started being a deal with Clive Davis, who J Records, and Ryan Fest, and Daniel Merriweather, whose album's coming out early next year that we just finished, the Dat Kings Roll Sonnet. It's a brilliant record. I'm really proud of it. That's come out through J, and then we just had a new deal with Jimmy Iovine and Interscope. So we have this rapper Wale from DC, who's record I'm working on now, and then the Rumble Strips from the UK, who are standing right behind
me. Yeah, who are a band that I like, and I played on Import, and they're going to come and perform on RXP in the UK next week, which we're very excited about. Great man. And I, you know, like I said, and you can do a cover of Back to Black. Is that how you ended up hooking up with them, Mark?
Yeah, I was in the label in the UK, and they had these 45s of the Back to Black single lying around, and I grabbed it, and it said Rumble Strips Remix, and I picked it up, and then they also did a remix, but they also did a version where Charlie's singing the lead on it, too.
Yeah, that's what I have as a B-side.
Yeah, I loved it, and I played it for Amy, who hates everything. And she said, oh, it's the nuts, you guys. And she looks at me and she goes, it's better than ours, isn't it? And I was like, it might be, I don't know. But it was cool because it was the only song that I wrote on Amy's record, even though, you know, produced a lot of it. And it was nice to after a year of looting and pillaging other people's songs, to hear someone do a version of one of your own songs. It's kind of nice.
No, it's great.